Labor Party. Many people wrote off Israel's center-left founding faction as politically dead, with early polls showing it failing to even pass the parliamentary threshold in the March 23rd election. But Labor has enjoyed a revival under its new leader, the former journalist and activist Merav Mikhaeli, which surveys now showing it's scoring anywhere from between 5 and 8 seats, which could prove the tipping point in crafting a coalition that prevents Prime Minister Netanyahu from retaining the premiership. But that also could raise some tough questions for Mikhaeli, which candidate for prime minister she is willing to have the party serve under, which party she is willing to sit in a coalition with, along with some of the new faces that have joined the party list under her. And she is here now in the studio to answer them, and hopefully in the latest of our joint I-24 News Yisrael Hayom election interviews, together with Ariel Kahana, the diplomatic correspondent of the Yisrael Hayom Daily. Merav, thanks for joining us.
Thank you for having me. It's a pleasure being here.
Well, let me start with a story that just broke today, certainly concerns your party. The Israel Supreme Court has decided to reverse a decision by the Central Election Committee that disqualified a member of your election list, Ibtissam Merane, from running in the election. The Central Elections Committee said she had made previous comments that people that called into question Israel's existence or existence as a Jewish state. Supreme Court now overturning that decision. She is free to run. I want to just first of all just get your reaction to that.
Yes, thank you. The Supreme Court has just, you know, gave its ruling, and we see this thing as behind us. Ibtissam Merane made it very clear that she, this is something that she wrote many, many years ago, over 10 years ago, and she went back on it completely. She made it very clear that she doesn't stand behind it anymore. She deliberately and knowingly joined a Zionist party. She's interested, and we are interested, in building now a better future for Israel, for the better of any and every citizen in Israel, a joint future for all the different parts of Israeli society. And that's what we're...
I follow up about that. If I may say, Kalev, if I may, I appreciate Merav as an ideological politician. And as you said, she raised the Labour Party from vanishing to new existence. And I appreciate honest and ideological politicians. But you said that Ibtissam Merane said what she said or wrote what she wrote many years ago. But one of her posts was in November 2020. She supported an Islamic Jihad operative. It's one example. And of course, the most horrible thing she wrote was about the Holocaust. Now, you are a famous granddaughter of Holocaust survivor, Yisrael Kastner, which is his legacy, which is controversial. We'll not go into that. But as a granddaughter of Holocaust survivors, How do you feel with those posts? Although they were many years ago.
My grandfather's legacy is not at all controversial. He is commemorated in Yad Vashem for rescuing at least 20,000 Jews. Ibtissam is married to a third-generation Holocaust Jew, whom together they raise a child who's, like they say, 100% Jewish and 100% a Muslim. She has a mother-in-law who's a second generation to the Holocaust. She has every respect to every bit of aspect about the Holocaust. As I said, the Supreme Court has made it very clear.
So you forgive her all what she said and wrote about that?
Of course, because she took responsibility. If she hadn't taken responsibility for those things, it would have been a whole different ballgame. But she had. She had taken responsibility. She said she goes back. She even called some of the texts pathetic because she was young and she was maybe in a different place. But it doesn't matter now. We have moved on from
this. Well, I don't know. I'm not going to go back on those comments, but you did say you were very careful in your wording. She has joined the Zionist Party.
Right.
Does that mean, I'm not asking if she is a Zionist, but she accepts, she accepts Zionism? Does she accept Israel as a Jewish state, which has certainly been the ethos even of the Labour Party, even among its more left-wing, let's say, factions?
She has said it specifically, both on primetime television and in the Supreme Court. She would not have come to a Zionist party if she hadn't. And as I said, she said it specifically. So really, it's You need partners in order to get Israel to the next level, to the next stage. You cannot continue to do what Netanyahu has been doing, and that is tearing us apart. We've seen during this coronavirus crisis how he's created an almost autonomy of ultra-Orthodox. And in different tactics, he is forcing the Arab society to be separated. And we see how the periphery is far from the center. This is completely not sustainable for the future of Israel. If Israel and I want Israel to last forever and ever, we need to be one society. Yes, diverse, with different communities, with different colors, but we need to be one society that collaborates, that wants to build a future together. This is what labor is now about. This is a prominent necessity for the future of Israel, and this is what I'm going to do and building now.
Just one more about that, but politically, from the political aspect, you welcome the Supreme Court decision, but politically, now once again, everybody are talking about her comments many years ago. Actually, isn't that negative from your aspect? Because, you know, some voters, some of them were part of the Labour Party, will move to the blue and white or Lapid, because once again, we are all talking about that.
You know, your editor in the French version asked me, isn't it a headache for me? And I said to him that it's much more than a headache. The incitement that became so so common in Israel. You cannot have a debate. You cannot apologize for anything. You can't go back on what you said. It's like if you are saying something wrong in the eyes of the right wing and they have a political gain in it, it automatically goes to delegitimization, which is the most dangerous thing.
Well, who made the delegitimization? It was by her.
I am not arguing, Mr. Kahana, with you. I'm just saying we need to move on. Things are very clear now. The Supreme Court has said and ruled, we are building a new future.
Okay, now you did say just now you are looking for, we have to be prepared to accept partners, new partners to unseat Prime Minister Netanyahu. So let's look at the partners you'd be willing to accept. Would you be willing to accept Naftali Bennett in a government, or Gideon Saar in a government, or have Labour sit in a government under either of those two men, possibly as Prime Minister?
The major and most meaningful question in these elections is, will Netanyahu have 61 mandates or more to form his Netanyahu-Ben-Gvir next government, or will there be 61 mandates and more for a block of change to replace Netanyahu? Now, if there is a 61, first of all, if there's a 61 or more block for Netanyahu, then it is very, very very dangerous for Israel. Okay. But if there is a block for change, then first of all, it will not be possible without Labour, obviously. And I think the strategic vote for anyone who wants to replace Netanyahu would be to vote for Labour. So you have a sure vote against Netanyahu. Everybody knows that about me, and you know that I didn't join the Netanyahu government, even when the rest of my faction did. And at the same time, you get the values that we believe in.
But I want to just interject a minute.
But to answer your question, we will certainly be a part of a coalition to replace Netanyahu. I think everyone will have to put aside many, many things that are in dispute in the Israeli society right now to form a coalition to rehabilitate and restore Israeli politics, Israeli democracy that is now really badly jeopardized. If we manage, if we have the votes, and if we manage to do that, then yes,
So under certain parameters, you would be willing to sit in a government which has either Naftali Bennett or Gideon Saar as the Prime Minister.
It's certainly not my dream coalition. My dream coalition is a strong, prominent center-left, but I cannot rule out sitting with both Naftali Bennett or Gideon Saar.
But you would recommend Yair Lapid as Prime Minister?
He is the closest to our views, obviously. Much closer than
people. So the answer is yes, you will recommend
him. Yes. Given, of course,
the numbers
let's remember.
We had in the polls, correct.
Yes, yeah. Not only the poll, not only the numbers, but also the ideology. I mean, as I said, we will have to put aside things
and maybe in scenarios you just described, maybe he should give up being prime minister for establishing coalitions that will replace Netanyahu. Would you call him to make this sacrifice?
You are so far ahead. Really? This is so much premature. Really? Okay. It's like unbelievable. But we need to concentrate on both getting the votes for change, and that the bloc will be composed of as many more mandates for labor in it, because really this is the next future of Israel.
Right. Marilyn, this is a point maybe speaks more to my viewers than Ariel's readers, but your party is going to bring something new into the Knesset, the first reform rabbi in the history of the Israeli parliament, Gilad Kariv, if you get...
I surprise you. I welcome that. Ties with diaspora are very, very important.
Well, it's ties with diaspora, but beyond that, what policies would you pursue, or will Gilad be pursuing there? In terms of making, for example, Reform Judaism more officially accepted within this country.
First of all, you've mentioned that this is the first time ever that we have a representative from the Reform movement.
That think has about it. It's like, chance, at least, of making
it's like
poll.
It's like not a minute too soon. Seriously, listen, I am ranked as the number one member of Knesset fighting for state and religion reforms in Israel. Have been since my beginning of the service in the Knesset. So. What we're going to do is do the same, fight for freedom of religion in Israel. The fact that you cannot be a Jew the way you choose to be a Jew in Israel, or you are not recognized equally. The irony and the absurd and the tragedy that the only country in the world in which not all Jews are recognized equally is the state and the homeland of the Jewish people is just... It's really tragic. And also, of course, not only recognition, but as Ariel said rightfully, the relationship with American Jewry, diaspora Jews in general, but American Jewry especially, it's very, very important. Allowing more diverse and more pluralism in religion in Israel. It cannot be a monopoly of a specific Orthodox group.
Our time is short. Can we have some policy questions?
This is a policy question, by the way.
I'm talking about geopolitics.
Okay, go ahead.
As the United States wants to go back to the JCPOA, as a nuclear agreement with Iran, do you support that? Or maybe do you support the government position, Netanyahu's position, that the United States should not go back to the JCPOA?
I declared the night I was elected that labor under me will certainly support going back to an upgraded agreement with Iran that will take care of also the problems will attend to the problems that the previous one did not. And these are the major interests of Israel's security, such as the ballistic missiles, the terror that they're funding in other places.
For now.
No, for
should
now.
They have about 30 seconds left.
Okay, Daria. So I will say that. Netanyahu has been prime minister for 12 years, speaking about Iran. Iran is closer to a nuclear bomb now than it's ever been. It's closer to our northern border than it's ever been.
So you prefer the U.S. position?
He has failed. I want to make sure that we get Iran as further away from a nuclear threat as we possibly can. An agreement is a proven better way to do that.
We will have to leave it at that, Mirav Mikhaeli. I think I should also wear the only female head of a major party in Israel.
With an egalitarian list.
Okay, we'll have to leave it at that. And Ariel Khanov, you saw.